Aloha and good evening. If you can, again, move a little bit further up, so we still have some empty seats up here, so that those who come in later can join us by just coming in into the back. That would be nice. So we shall begin. At the beginning of any meetings that we have in Micronesia, it is always customary for us to do the usual acknowledgement and praise to our Heavenly Father, who is the author of our lives, not only for this beautiful venue that we're assembling in, but for the gift of life given to each and every one of us this evening. I also want to pay my respect, or our collective respect, to this land as we set a foot, this Aina, as well as paying respect to the elders among us, the traditional civic and church leaders, prominent citizens that are with us this evening. We are extremely grateful that you have taken the time to be with us, because we know that a good many of you have obligations to family, to school, to church, and what have you. What you have today is the Committee 2023 that a good many of you might have heard of. This is the committee that is made by the President of our nation, who is the chairman, and the other members are the governors of the constituent states in our Federation. Unfortunately, because of important commitments at home, they're not able to make it. They are here basically to conduct public education, public awareness on the various initiatives and mandates that they have put together to enable us to prepare ourselves and our nation for the combat termination in 2023. So it's been quite a journey for this committee, not only at home, but abroad. They have started out in Guam, and then they started out in Honolulu with the Chukis. We have come from Maui, and now to Hilo, the penultimate destination, the second to the last, because after this, we will be heading to Honolulu for a meeting with the Ponopeans, the Kosrayans, and the Yapis. I am so happy to see such a good mix. All our states are represented here today. Thank you so much for being here. So we want to thank you. I want to take this opportunity to thank you on behalf of the committee for this hospitable and warm aloha that you have given us, and for this excellent venue that you have provided for us. I want to thank those who have provided all these that we have seen around here, as well as outside, including this venue. Thank you very much, those behind the scene. And I could name just Fidalino, Ratior, but there are others, and I'm sorry that I wouldn't be able to name all of you. Thank you very much for preparing this for us. Before I introduce a delegation for your benefit, I would like to ask for a prayer for the grace. And I understand a gentleman out there is willing to do that for us. Would you please, I'm sorry I don't remember your name, but if you could kindly help us with a prayer, that would be much appreciated. Frank, please.
Let us pray. Should I pray for the food too?
Yes.
Yes. We pray. Father God, we magnify your name once more. We put your name high above all things, and you are the creator of all creations. Father God, we ask that you bless us for this opportunity that we have to mingle with our leaders, people that you love. Bring them all over for us to meet at this place, at this moment. Father God, for your word says, my people perish without vision. We pray that you give us that vision. We pray that you give us wisdom and knowledge for better understanding and being one heart, in one accord in all that we do and discuss today. We pray for our refreshment, and we pray and hope that you bless those hands that prepare all this food. Give them double portion in all that they do, in all that we do today. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Frank. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce the members of our delegation. And I will start with the head of the delegation, who is the head of our nation and our government. He's our president, His Excellency, Manny Mori. Accompanying is the First Lady, Emma Mori. There are some staff members of the committee, and I'm pleased to also introduce them. First, the director of the Office of SPOC. You might have heard this new agency of our government, created by our president. It is called Statistics, Budget, Overseas Development Assistance, and Compact Management. That's Evelyn Adolf, the director of SPOC. Working alongside Ms. Adolf at SPOC is a ADB, Asia Development Bank assigned economist consultant. His name is Rob Solomon from New Zealand. The right-hand man, I often call, of the president, because he's the chief of staff, Leo A. Falcom Jr. A former congressman, and now is back at the Department of Resources and Development at your national government as a trade advisor, Mr. Roger Mori. And tagging along is Robin Fritz, Foreign Service Officer, and myself from your Consulate General of Honolulu. I would like to mention that Robin and I have brought your office to you, as we always do when we come to your islands. We have to do that. So we are very grateful that President has enabled us or allowed us to be able to bring your office. So we will be serving citizens' documents if you so need. Please avail yourself. There is one person that I would like to recognize her presence, and I thank her profusely for being with us. The Vice Chancellor of Student Affairs. Her name is Gail Makunakane London. Sorry.
Aloha mai kako. On behalf of the University of Hawaii at Hilo and Chancellor Don Strini, we'd like to welcome President, First Lady, and the committee to the University of Hawaii at Hilo. The Chancellor sends his best regards and his regrets that he could not be here. He's actually in Kona tonight. I wanted to thank you for being here, for allowing an opportunity for the citizens of Micronesia, as well as our students here, to have an opportunity to engage with you this evening. And I wanted to especially welcome home, Emma, to UH Hilo. Many of you may know that Emma's an alumna of UH Hilo, and we're so proud of her for being here tonight, as well as others that I've had the opportunity to work with over the years. So mahalo again, and we look forward to hearing what you have to share this evening.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we will now have a song so we can
kind of relax into our chairs. Buster, please hit it.
Yes.
Our national anthem, of course. And please all stand or rise. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to hand on the mic to Fidalino. You don't have to do that. Okay. So we have a simple program, but it's certainly not short. We want to be able to engage with you. So I'm going to hand over to our facilitator this evening to enable us or help us to go through this whole program. I will call on the Chief of Staff to do that.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I would like to join the Congen in paying my respects to His Excellency, President Mori, First Lady, Director Adolf, the Congen himself, and of course, all of you who are here this evening to avail your time of this presentation. Special respects to those community leaders from the FSM who are here in Hilo, and all who could have made the time to come by tonight. The Congen has briefly alluded to, the 2023 Planning Committee is a committee that was commissioned by the President that consists of the four governors of the four states, plus the President as the chairman. He specifically commissioned this committee with a task and with a mandate to come up with an action plan, a plan that will address the challenges that will face us, that are going to face us inevitably in the year 2023. The Congen mentioned something about the compact in 2023. A little bit of a clarification on the compact itself. The compact of free association with the United States does not terminate in the year 2023. The compact itself is an enduring agreement between the two countries, the two partner countries. What does terminate in 2023 is the economic or financial assistance package that comes with that amended compact. That is what's scheduled to terminate. And that, as many of us might know, is termed mainly our sector grants, which is what form the money comes in. And so with that in mind, and with the with that date relatively rapidly approaching, the President has commissioned his committee to come up with a plan to address the challenges that will face us as a result of that termination. And so what you are going to hear this evening in terms of the presentation is a summary or the high points of the 2023 action plan. That plan in its entirety actually exists in a little bit more of a thicker volume. It's, I believe, about 70-ish pages, which I'm sure the director of SPOC will cover a little bit later. But what we will do in this presentation this evening is it'll be broken down into three parts. The first part is going to introduce or describe to all of us here tonight the challenges that we face. That's going to be the first one so that we all have a common picture from which to start when we get into the other portions of the action plan itself. So that's the first part, is the economic and fiscal challenges. Part two is going to go through the high points of the action plan itself, and those kind of the meat of the plan and what has been laid out, what is currently in progress, and what still remains to be done. The third part of this action plan is going to cover the financing or the resourcing component of this plan. As we all are probably familiar with, there have been numerous plans throughout the FSM for many, many years to try and do things in the way of development. Many of those plans have not materialized the way that we have probably would have liked them to materialize. And so this action plan is going to attempt to describe some of those recurring challenges in addition to what we need to and what we are currently doing about them. Because there's a specific reason why this plan is called an action plan, and that is because we have to go beyond formulation of a plan. We've got to put it into action and implement. So following the third portion of the plan, which is the financing component, we will open up the discussion to be an interactive question and answer period for all of you to please help us with one of the most important parts of this briefing, and that is your input, your comments, your questions, recommendations, and observations about the plan. It is the last part of the plan, but is probably one of the most important parts of the plan. It is one of the reasons why the President has made a dedicated effort to take this plan out and socialize it with all citizens. We have been through all the states already, twice, and then we are trying to canvass as many of our citizens as we possibly can in the time frame before finalization of that plan, which takes place, scheduled to finalize that plan in January of next year, which is right around the corner. So I will, that's just the general layout of how we're going to conduct this briefing this evening. And I will, without further delay, turn it over to His Excellency President Mori for any opening comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Let me thank the lady who gave me the lay. Thank you so much. And I want to thank, let me first add my word of thanks to our Lord, who controls everything. And thank you so much for availing yourself to join us this evening to discuss and maybe share information. We will share parts of the plan with you. We also want some feedback from you. it is very important that you participate, giving us some viewpoint as far as you view the plan from here, from Hilo, or from parts of the United States. It is important so that we can integrate your inputs in the final document of this plan. As mentioned by the chief, the most important component that we have had is the financial component of it. Most plans that we have gone through that I've seen in my lifetime have been shelved because they lack the financial aspect of it. So this time we have the financial scheme to it to make sure that the private sector takes the driver's seat this time instead of the government taking the driver's seat all the time. So that is the main difference with this plan. This plan is designed on the premise that the private sector is going to take over, is going to drive our economy instead of the government, which have been doing over the doing it for the past, let's say 40 years. And so the private sector needs funding. And the private sector is not going to get the money from the government, but it will borrow the money from the banks. As you know, the banks have hold so much of our money in terms of deposits. And instead of giving out the money to develop our economy, they invest the money somewhere in New York or San Francisco or wherever they invest excess funds from all over the world. So this time we want to pull back some of this money and give it to the private sector and develop our economy. I truly believe that this strategy is going to work because it has worked in most of the countries that I know of, especially in democratic countries. And since FSM is a democratic country, it should work. The other key component of the this plan, which is also very important, is that it has a timetable. It would have a 3-year horizon. The strategic plan, which Director Adolf is going to talk about, is a general plan for the nation, which is about 20 years horizon. It has a term of 20 years to be implemented. Well, guess what? Only part of this plan has been implemented through the allotment of compact sector grants. And therefore, the private sector continue to be ignored. But this plan is going to action a portion of the strategic plan focusing on the private sector. Okay, so I'm not going to go into the plan itself, but the reason why I am very confident that this plan is going to work, it has a time horizon. We have identified the source of funding. We have also identified the people and the departments, and of course the private sector to get involved. All of these people together, agencies and governments, when they work together, we are very confident that this plan would work. And this is the first time that, as I mentioned earlier, this is the first time the private sector has given an important role in our economic endeavor. And let me define private sector in our country right now. What is private sector, as far as I see, is simply to buy, process materials, food, goods, and then distribute to to the citizens or the consumers. That's our private sector. That's the general definition of our private sector. So when they say private sector, we really don't have a private sector. They are simply stores that purchase partly and fully processed goods and then redistribute, sell to consumers in the stores. We have to reduce that or minimize the importation of consumer goods. Instead, we have to rely partly on imported as well as processed goods, especially food items that we can process ourselves. So because the private sector has really not existed, we have to give the private sector the chance by infusing funds into the private sector. And it's not simple. Believe me, it's not simple. It's not going to happen within 3 years, even 10 years. It's going to take time. Reason? Let me just use an example. If you're planning on owning a business, doesn't matter what, you have to go through the process of developing your business application or business plans, right? When you finish that, you submit a plan or an application to the banks. And it also takes time. The bank would then give you the money, and then you start. When you start, it's about 2 to 3 years down the road already. Your business is not going to make money until after 2 or 3 years. And because the risky period, for any businesses, for the first up to the third year, it's so risky. The business has to take a very deliberate time to make sure that it survives the competition, that the employees know what they're doing, that the owner understand the market. Let me not get into that section here. But what I'm trying to say is, even if we give the private sector the driver's seat now, it is going to take about 10 years. And it's just about the right time before 2023 ends and we move into 2024. So that's why I decided that instead of waiting until 2023 and then do something, we have to do something 10 years before 2024. It's a long process. Let me end here, and I want to thank you so much for your presence. The staff would go through the different parts of the plan. I think I would be useful in responding to questions. And I would like to also ask the staff if we can give just 10 minutes to those chukis who want to talk about, what was that, the committee that came up here to talk about a political status or something, because it has linkage to what we're doing, and we cannot pretend that it's not going to affect what we're doing right now. It has linkages and it has impacts. It would have impacts. So let's understand each other how this thing is going to impact if it's successful. Okay? Is that fair? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. So when we get to the question and answer period, what we will do is try to entertain and discuss and dialogue as much as we can on the contents and your observations of this plan. Once we're pretty confident that we've covered all that, then we'll give some special time and some needed time to address what the president has just mentioned. Okay, so I will hand it off now to the director of SPOC to do her portion of the briefing.
Thank you, Chief. I want to start off by thanking gentleman Frank for the wise words of prayer to start us off. And also my respects and greetings to all of you this morning, this evening. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to walk us through the first part of our presentation to introduce to you the 2023 action plan. I will hand it over to Mr. Roger Mori to go over the second part of the presentation, and then I will finish the third part of the presentation, which covers the financing component of the 2023 action plan. The 2023 planning committee that was formed by President Mori to address this challenge that we face in our future has been doing its work and met in its last meeting on October 30th to consider the draft action plan that we're here to share with you this evening. We are working to finalize the plan, and as we do this, the president is very interested for us to share with the citizens as much as possible what the contents of the plan are. And that's why we're here, to conduct part of the, to conduct the public awareness. As the chief of staff indicated earlier, the plan is to finalize the action plan in January. The state and national leadership conference is convening in January. And the plan is to then present it to the State National Leadership Conference, or the SNLC, for their consideration and hopefully endorsement, so it can be accepted. So the first part of our presentation this evening covers the first section in this action plan. This is a copy, a hard copy of the draft action plan. The draft action plan starts off by describing the fiscal and economic challenge that the FSM faces. Under the amended compact with between the United States and the FSM receives annual compact grants from the U.S. These grants support primarily the service delivery in health and education in your state governments back home, and also infrastructure. These are the three key sectors that are funded with the infrastructure grants. And today, your state governments still rely on more than 70% of their budgets to be funded from these compact grants that we're talking about. So more than 70%. In some cases like Kosrae, the compact sector grants fund more than 80% of its state budget. So we're not talking about an insignificant portion of your state, but of the state budgets back home. In 2023, under the amended compact, the FSM is scheduled to receive about 94.5 million in these annual grants. In 2023, the last year of funding under the amended compact agreement. In 2024, per the compact treaty, we will stop receiving these compact annual grants. In its place, we will receive earnings from the compact trust fund that has been established under the treaty, and contributions are being made into this trust fund on an annual basis. So today we know what the amount of funds are there in the trust fund corpus. We also know what is scheduled to come down in terms of annual contributions into the compact trust fund. for the next 9 years until the last funding period, which is 2023. Based on this information, we've calculated that the amount of money that will be in the trust fund corpus in 2023, on which earnings can be drawn upon to support the government operations in place of the annual sector grants, is going to be short by a projected amount of $600 million. The amount that is needed, or the target amount that is needed to be in the trust fund corpus in 2024, in order for there to be a smooth transition from the 94.5 million annual grants that we receive, is 1.8. What we're estimating will be available in the compact trust fund is only 1.2 about. So that leaves us with a shortfall in the corpus of the fund of $600 million. Because of this shortfall, comes 2024, the earnings that that will be available to be drawn on by the FSM governments to support our state budgets in lieu of the 94.5 million is gonna be only 54.1 million. Using an interest rate of 6%. So assuming that the trust fund is going to yield 6% rate of return, we can expect to get 54.1 million in 2024 instead of 94 million that we were getting in 2023. So this is the source of the budgetary, the fiscal gap, or the budgetary problem that we're facing. And this is the primary reason why the 2023 committee has been established in order to develop an action plan that would steer us in a direction to avoid that kind of fiscal cliff that you see in the picture. I will qualify that by saying that the 54 million that we can draw down is the maximum amount. The Compact Trust Fund has rules. And the rule is that we cannot touch the corpus. We can only touch the interest earnings. But a committee will be established to make decisions on what gets to go down to the FSM governments. And it says that we can receive a maximum of up to. It can be less. The committee can decide in 2024 and any year after to allocate a lesser amount than the interest earnings. So the budget, the fiscal gap can actually be worse. The 40 million fiscal gap or budgetary shortfall is somewhat arbitrary because it's a nationwide figure. As you all know, our state governments have complete fiscal autonomy. Kosrae State has its own budget, Juuk State has its own budget, and so on and so forth. Translated state by state, this is what each of the state governments' share of that budgetary shortfall is. So if you're from Kosrae, your state government will be facing a budgetary shortfall of 55.8 million. Or it will go from receiving 11.2 million in sector grants in 2023 down to receiving only 5.4 in interest income from the trust fund in 2024. For the biggest state, Juuk, which receives most of the funding because it has the biggest population, the fiscal gap or budgetary shortfall for that state is 21.7. Because it's going from receiving 39.1 million in 2023 down to receiving only 17.4 in 2024, and so on. One of the things that I point out from this table is that the national government, because it does not rely on compact sector grants, it relies primarily on the domestic revenues, which it has plenty of. It's the only government that does not face the budgetary shortfall that all your state governments will face in 2024. Is this a problem that the nation and your leaders can afford to ignore? Well, clearly no. And the reason why is because that number is huge, the drop in that particular resource. The magnitude is huge, but more importantly than that, probably, is the fact that what I mentioned earlier, those grants go to fund the very priority services, your schools, the hospitals, and the infrastructure sector. These are the areas that get funded. So just imagine for Chuuk State, 31% of the funding is going to education and 28% for the hospital. So what we saw earlier is that Chuuk is going to face about 50, a little bit more than 50% cut in the funding that goes to fund the services in the hospital and the schools. So just imagine the schools being reduced in teachers by half. Same with the hospital. So it's not a problem that our leaders can afford to not resolve. And that's why the president, despite the fact that the problem does not exist at the national government, has created the committee to devise a plan to address this problem so that comes 2024, we're not facing this. The only point that I should emphasize from this picture, as you can see in 2024, is the big budgetary shortfall or the fiscal cliff in 2024. But beyond that, it doesn't get better. Beyond that, if the FSM doesn't do anything, if the FSM is not successful in implementing this action plan or similar actions, the amount that we will receive under the trust fund, the real value of it will only diminish. And this is because the way that the compact trust fund is set up, it's not structured to protect the real value of the corpus of the trust fund. So the interest earnings every year will go down in real value. We don't just have a fiscal challenge. Fiscal relates to the budget, the government finances. The whole economy also has a challenge. What you see here is that over the past 10 years, between 23 and 2013, we have not been successful in growing the economy. In 2013, real GDP or real gross domestic product for the FSM was slightly lower than what it was in 2003. During the discussions, in the interest of getting us through the rest of the presentation, we may discuss what some of the contributing factors are to this lack of growth. So we have a fiscal challenge and we have an economic challenge. And that is basically what you will find in the first section of the action plan. I'll now turn it over to Mr. Roger Mori to go through the second part, which is the action plan on our growth strategy.
Thank you. Nebuchadnezzar, Tiro, aloha, and as we say, Chuuk, mele kaliki naka. President that often told us to try to be brief and be passionate when we make our presentations. The problem at times is that we tend to be too passionate and try to be brief, that we tend to skip some very important parts of the presentations. But I believe you have copies of the slides, so whatever that I may miss in presenting the second portion of the presentation, you can refer to the handouts, and then during the Q&A session, bring those up if you have questions, and we can try to address them. So with that, let me go into the my portion of the presentation. Evelyn had painted a very grim picture, very grim scenario as to what will happen if we do not do anything, given the cliff that dropped from fiscal year 2023 to 2024 with regards to financial amounts that the FSM will be getting under or at the loss of these financial assistance through the compact. So the question is, what can we do? Do we want to do something, or do we want to let it go and just play and keep things as they are? The plan that the president has recommended and put into action calls for and is in support of the FSM national policies of growing the economy through the development of the four economic sectors that includes agriculture, fisheries, tourism, and energy. The second policy that the plan supports is the development of these sectors to be led by the private sector. So the plan itself, as we would go through, identifies some opportunities as well as challenges in these sectors that we need to overcome in order to provide the necessary support to the private sector for the private sector to be able to generate the needed revenue that we will need to make up for the losses of the compact fiscal assistance. The problem that the private sector often faces in trying to develop the businesses in the FSM involves poor economic infrastructure that we still face, as Evelyn and also the president had alluded to earlier, access to finance or credit for the business to be able to develop or establish their businesses. We still have land issues, which are the major impediments to development in the states. Another impediment is the poorly trained workforce or employees that we have in the nation. Aside from that, or those, we also have still have weak institutions and coordination between the institutions that facilitate assistance to the private sector. The islands, as you know, given the makeup of our islands, are still vulnerable to natural disasters and climate change. And we may not be able to stop the typhoons or the high tide, but we certainly can do what we can to mitigate the effects and try to make plans to lessen the impacts of the these natural disasters. We need to also be able to learn how to process and learn the technologies to process the resources that we get from our land in terms of agricultural products, fisheries products. And another, the major impediment that also affect development include the cost, the rising cost of fuel, which contribute to the high cost of utilities and high cost of transportation, which in turn makes the goods transportation of goods or the sale of goods be very high. The last item under this the impediments is we still need to put in place some certain strategic policies or directions, and we are still working on some of these. In the tourism sector, there are certain opportunities that can create possibilities for business development, and these are based on the development of the tourism policy that is sustainable and that the nation can be able to sustain. The policy also calls for the continued consultations between the state and the national governments through the establishment of a national tourism authority that can hold consultation meetings to discuss the problems and try to identify solutions. Strengthening and expanding the hospitality and tourism management training is also a need that needs to be acted upon and implemented to enable the growth of development in the tourism sector. The states have also put in place certain tourism development plans that will be incorporated in the implementation of this 2023 action plan and would be part of the plan. There is also discussion and plan to establish a major hotel in one of the states that can attract tourists from the neighboring markets as the Asian market. That would then be used as a central, collecting point of where tourists can first come to and then go out to the other three states. That is a major development that will involve a lot of investment. And as you know, we do not have that capacity and we need to attract or invite investors from outside that can then bring in the technical know-how, the market, along with possibly their own airline that can bring in the tourists and provide an alternative way, alternative airline that the nation can rely on in bringing in tourists as well as in transporting goods to the outside market. In the area of agriculture, there is the plan also calls for the establishment of central markets that could be used to market agricultural products as well as fisheries and handicrafts. It also calls for establishment of a feed mill using local materials from the fisheries and agriculture byproducts to provide feed to support these industries at lower prices. Quarantine and treatment processing facilities would need to be also put in place that can support our export, the exportation of our goods, as well as to build producers' capacity that would be able to meet the demand of outside markets in providing the necessary products in both agriculture and fisheries. There is a plan that is ongoing or activity that is ongoing. The our FSM Petroleum Corporation has now taken over the copra industry, the development of the copra industry to produce crude oil or virgin oil from coconuts that can be used for the cosmetic market as well as to supplement fuel to provide supplemental fuel to the needs of the nation. In the fisheries sector, the plan also calls for the promotion of small-scale community-managed aquaculture projects, establishment of a competent authority that can be then used or be the authority to certify or provide certifications on potential export products in the fisheries area, also in the agriculture sector. Packaging, storage, and marketing of fisheries products is also needed for our people to be trained in, to have that capability to meet the demands of external markets, even if niche market to begin with. And this also includes value adding to our fisheries products that can provide additional revenue aside from the fishing license fees that we're getting from the distant water fisheries companies that are fishing in our waters. So instead of just relying on the fish that is caught and the license fees that the fishing companies pay, we have to put in some processing facilities in the nation to provide value adding and then also generate additional revenues aside from the fishing license fees. In the area of support infrastructures, particularly in energy, as well as telecommunications, actions that are recommended in this area per the energy policy that has been adopted in 2012, it calls for meeting the target of using renewable energy up to 30% by the year 2020. And we have already secured, the nation has already secured funding support from donor agencies and donor partners such as the EU and Japan that is currently funding development of solar power projects in our outer islands. Capacity building in the area of maintenance for these infrastructures in energy is very much needed. So that is another role that the government will also provide to support the provision of these new and renewable energy programs. As you may know, our telecommunication industry has been liberalized through the amendment of the FSM telecommunication law, which now provides for additional or can allow for additional telecommunication companies to be established in our nation. That can in turn lower the cost of telecommunication provision to the people and also to future businesses. In this area, the nation has already secured $50 million from the World Bank for the development and improvement of telecommunication in the nation. Now, earlier we said that the private sector is to be the lead agency or to take the lead in developing or growing our economy. The problem though is that there remains impediments that tend to impede the progress that our private sector makes because these impediments impede or they cause problems to the private individuals that want to establish businesses. Some of these impediments include transparency and access to information, existence of the five individual and ambiguous foreign investment laws in the FSM. And these include the investment law for the FSM investment law, that's for the nation, and then the respective foreign investment laws for the states. These need to be reviewed and perhaps amended to further enable the investment environment so that businesses or potential investors from outside would be willing to come in and invest in our country. Again, land, the issue of land registration of land transactions and availability of these information is very limited, which costs or further impede the development of private sector. Now, what the government has done or is going to put in place to help mitigate these impediments include tax reform that the nation has tried to put in place. There has been problems with regards to implementation of the tax reform. Nevertheless, we are still pursuing to assure that the efforts in reforming our current tax structure continues. We are looking at the completion of surveying potential land sites that can be used to host investment or businesses in each of the states. And as I said earlier, we will be reviewing the investment laws in the four states, including the national government law. And to consolidate the investment promotion activities at the national government to enable ease of providing information to potential investors that want to come in and invest. Another activity that we are looking at, or the plan is proposing to implement is to provide the access to credit and finance to businesses to enable them to be established and grow to generate the needed revenue that we will need comes 2024. And that leads us to the third section of the presentation that the director of SPOC had alluded to that she will be doing after this. So with that, we will answer questions relative to the section of the presentation that is relevant to the plan itself, if you do have questions during the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mori. We will move right along and into the last portion of the plan right now before we get into question and answer. Director.
Thank you, Chief. I think you all will agree with us that for this plan to be effective, it has to have the financing component. And that's what is covered in the final section of the plan, and is what I'm going to highlight to you now. In addition to the 2023 Investment Development Fund, which the President has outlined sum up, and I will also discuss that a little bit later, and FSM Development Bank reform. There are also three other key sources of financing for this action plan or financing for the growth strategy. One is foreign investment reform. I think all throughout the world, there is very important lesson in the development world that for any developing and resource-scarce country such as the FSM, to be successful in developing our economy, to be private sector-led, we need the injection of foreign investment. So the plan identifies that foreign investors, or the, there is a crucial role for foreign investment to come in and help to finance the growth that we need to see happen. We cannot just do it with our own money. We need to open the doors for the right kind of foreign investment. But in order for foreign investors to be attracted to invest in our economy, we have some things to do, and some of that has already been outlined in Roger's part of the presentation. We need to improve and eliminate or get rid of most if not all of the impediments that are making our economy to be perceived as one of the worst places to invest money in the world. So this is part of the action plan, is to do that, to open the door for the right kinds of foreign investment to come in. For example, Roger mentioned flagship hotels. Flagship hotels is a specialty of foreign investors. There are foreign investors who are good in, who have enough money and enough know-how to go in and build and manage these kinds of flagship hotels that can be a source of income, not for the, not only for the people that they employ, but in terms of the taxes that the tourists bring. And also, the agriculture, the farmers and the fishermen who will be selling produce to the hotels if they were to be successfully established. So the action plan sees the role of foreign investment funding as one of the keys to financing our growth. The action plan also recognizes overseas development assistance or the external grants that we receive as a potential source of financing for our growth. Historically, what we've seen is that not all of the external grants that we received in the past has been smartly used for things that will facilitate development. We've learned that lesson. As a result, the President Mori submitted to Congress ODA policy, or Overseas Development Policy, that articulates and sets up the institutional setup to enable us to be more coordinated in channeling and prioritizing where our development needs are, so that when we go and ask our donors for grants, they are more targeted to what our development needs are, as opposed to being more ad hoc as they have been in the past. So we see that the channeling of ODA to development initiatives and private sector enabling activities is also a source of financing for the things that we want to achieve in our action plan. Public projects. I don't know if how many of you like public projects like I do. They're good, and they are, I think they're in the FSM to stay, like they are in most other countries or all countries. But the action plan also recognizes we've done review of the kinds of public projects that have been appropriated in the past and implemented. And based on the composition of the kinds of projects that there are, I mean, there are economic projects, there are projects that are for infrastructure, there are projects that fund government services, and then there are projects that are just for social services. But I think we all know that some of those are handouts disguised as social services. So what the action plan recognizes is that there is room for taking more of that those public project funds and channeling them towards activities that will be more supportive of helping the private sector to grow and be more sustainable. The committee has been, the secretariat and the staffing under the guidance of the president and the committee has been working on putting together the investment, 2023 investment development fund for some time now. Several months ago, the president submitted to Congress the 2023 investment development fund legislation because it needs to be set up by legislation. So he submitted the enabling legislation proposal to Congress for enactment, as well as request for funding in the amount of $15 million per year as part of the 2015 budget submission. The purpose of the fund is to provide equity capital to private sector investments that have potential to create employment and net inflow of revenue into the FSM. One of the problems with private growing the private sector in the FSM is access to financing. And we heard that throughout the states when we met with them. When you ask the banks why they're investing, as President Morris said, most of the cash. Our banking system in the FSM is very liquid. It has a lot of money, as the president said. But the banks, Development Bank and the commercial banks, are not investing this money in business projects in the FSM. They're not loaning out the money to support investments in the FSM. They're sending it overseas to be investment. The explanation that the banks have is that there is a lack of good fundable business proposals that they receive. And there is also, in some cases where they receive good business proposals, the proponents are lacking in the equity requirement. If you've applied for a business loan, you will know that all the banks will require an equity contribution. Most of them require 20% equity contribution. So there are some people who have good business ideas, but they don't have enough assets, including cash, to be able to put up, to serve as their equity requirement that most banks have. This fund is being established to address that problem that some people have, who have good ideas on project in private sector projects or businesses that can be established, create jobs, provide income sources, pay taxes, but they just cannot get off the ground because they cannot get their loans approved from the bank because they don't have enough equity. For those kinds of situations, these investors can go to the Investment Development Fund, and the proposed legislation has it that this fund will be managed by the FSM Development Bank, but will be governed by a separate board of directors, not the FSMDB board. The Development Bank is just going to be the administrative arm of this fund, but the decisions relating to the fund, who gets approved for funding, those decisions get to be made by a board that is set up separately from the Development Bank board. If you're an investor who has a good business proposal, but the only thing is that the bank cannot give you a loan because you don't meet their equity requirement, you can go to this fund and apply and get equity put up by this so that you can be successful in accessing the funding. It's not meant to replace or compete with the debt financing or the loan financing from the banks, but it's meant to complement it. It's meant to help to leverage it. It's meant to address the access to financing problem that we see in the FSM now. Just as an update to that, I'm happy to report that Congress has in its last session appropriated $5 million towards the $15 million that the president has requested in 2015. So we're very hopeful that they will put up the rest of the funding. There is also room for reform of the Development Bank. As I'm sure all of you know, our Development Bank was set up for the purpose of providing debt financing to support businesses in the FSM. But in order for them to more effectively play that role, the action plan articulates that there needs to be reevaluation of their lending policies to small businesses, which is part of their mandate, and a review of their interest rates. Their interest rates are at competitive levels with the commercial banks. So there needs to be a review of that. In terms of the problem with what the banks are saying that they don't receive enough, there's a shortage of good business proposals. They've also set up a new business development officer to strengthen the entrepreneurs' capacity, business people's capacity to formulate good projects. And a business training institute is being established and servicing businesses who need this kind of service. The 2023 IDF also has business advisory support that will be part of it. So if you are an applicant who is successful in accessing the equity financing from the 2023 IDF, you will be qualified to be provided with business advisory support as long as you still have that equity contribution in your business. I'm almost done. That's our action plan. In summary, it's a 71-page long document. Compared to, I don't know how many of you have heard of our strategic development plan, the SDP, FSM Strategic Development Plan. The implementation timeframe for that very huge and comprehensive three-volume plan is 20 years, from 2004 to 2023. This 2023 action plan, although it's called 2023, the implementation time frame is 3 years, 2015 to 2013. On page 16 to 19 of the action plan is the action plan matrix, which lists specific actions that will be undertaken over the course of the next 3 years. The responsible agencies for overseeing the implementation of those specific actions and the time frame. On page 51 of the action plan, you'll find the results framework, which is based on the action plan matrix. The results matrix will be used as the basis for active monitoring of the implementation of the specific actions that are outlined in the action plan. I think that many of you will agree that what we suffer from is a problem of implementation. We have plans that have not been implemented. So the committee is putting a lot of focus and emphasis on ensuring that there is effective implementation of the items, the action items that are outlined in the action plan by having a very active monitoring of the actions that are outlined in there and reporting to the leadership. What we are projecting in our economic model is that the negative growth that we saw between 2003 and 2013, that was a period of negative growth, those 10 years. What we're saying is that all the actions that are contained in this action plan, with that, we will see a positive growth that is led by private sector development for the next 9 years. And the target growth is 2%. And that might seem unambitious by itself, but I think that if you compare it with historical performance of our economy, it's not too ambitious. And finally, if we implement all of these actions, the problem that I showed you in the first part of the presentation, which is a huge fiscal gap in 2023, to be followed by budgetary shortfalls thereafter, can be resolved entirely by the implementation of the action plan that we've just shared with you. Thank you very much for your attention.
Chief, can I interject? The question that may raise in your mind when these presentations were made is, how come there has not been any economic growth led by private sector for the past years? That's a fair question. And the reason is because of the many impediments and because government dominate all activities. And so we want to reverse that. But the private sector I was talking about, I did not clarify what private sector I was talking about. It is both investors from FSM and foreign investment. Now, how do we attract foreign investment? Because they are also looking at other places or other markets in our neighborhood, Palau, Masalainas, Guam, Cinema. Well, we have some advantages and disadvantages, which Roger Mori has outlined. But we have to capitalize on our advantages. And some of the advantages we look at would be concentrating on the four sectors, tourism, agriculture, fisheries, and energy. We are very confident that if we start with tourism, the other sectors will support and will become successful. And there is already knocks on the door for investment. But there are still major impediments that need to be removed. And one of them is land. And land, you cannot have successful investment if there is no land. And land has to be equipped with at least the basic infrastructure. That's why we are asking that the government let go the private sector and invest mostly in infrastructure as well as develop our manpower capability. We have ample amount of money, but we're not able to throw it out from the banks and have the private sector utilize these funds for the reasons that we have already discussed. What are the incentives that we are going to give them? Tax for one, and others would be perhaps discussed later on. But we have experimented with one investment that is working very well. It is led by MRA. MRA program started and we had serious problems because the government's agencies don't seem to work together very well. We made some rules that when a document
such as application is transmitted to the FSM, it must have only 7 days a turnaround period. And we have achieved that. As a result, the investment on led by MRE, Micronesian, what is it?
Registrar
Corporation has made the first investment that we receive, or the revenue that we receive was 500 2 years ago. Just this year, we made $22 million. We're not discouraged that there are so many impediments and we may not attract for investment. It is just to change some rules and have the governments work together to help the private sector from foreign investors. So there is opportunity. So if you ask the question, are you sure that it's going to work? I am very confident that it's going to work. It's just going to take some time, and it's going to take a lot of persuasion for the state governments and the state leaders, as well as the national government and national leaders, to move forward on it. Chief.
Thank you, Mr. President. Well, that pretty much wraps up the presentation portion of this as we roll into question and answer period and dialogue. Now, let me take just a couple of very brief moments to try and wrap up and summarize for you what you have heard today. I will also remind everybody that the actual action plan sits on the SPOC website. The action plan that this presentation was taken from, in more detail, is sitting on a website with SPOC, and they'll be more than happy to provide you with that address, which is on this slide, at the bottom of this slide, www.spoc.fm. The actual action plan is in there. It also includes, I believe it also includes the framework for the investment development fund that was just discussed by Director Adolf. So what you got today was kind of a summary. The high points, the important parts, the parts that we feel need to be communicated to all of our citizens. So what was all of this about? Very briefly, if you take anything away from this gathering this evening, is that we face a couple of problems. We face a budget problem in 2023, and we face an economic problem that has been enduring for many years. The economy has not grown. You saw that. That is a challenge that we have faced historically. We were always knowledgeable that this budget problem was going to hit us in 2023. But there hasn't been much movement to try and mitigate that sooner than later. What the president is doing now is he's trying to ensure that we collectively adopt a little bit of an urgency towards this budget issue that's coming. It is important, it's significant, and it's going to impact all of our families throughout the nation. Somehow, I know that that impact is going to make it back to you, whether you're still here or whether you're headed back to Kosrae, Juk, or Yap, or Pumpe. It's going to impact you. It will have effect because your families will be involved back home. We are going to need to rely on those things that you are learning here, those skills that you are able to acquire here that you cannot perhaps access back home right now, to be able to assist the nation in its growth, in its continued growth. So we've got a budget problem, an economic problem. We must agree, I hope you will all agree, that regardless of what happens to the compact in 2023, the economy still needs to be grown. It doesn't matter whether the compact is 2023 is looming or not. We cannot afford to continue this flatline growth of economy. It just will not sustain our nation for the future. Something has to be done with it. This action plan attempts to address that. So those are the two problems. The action plan has addressed is attempting to address those two problems through what? Through private sector direct involvement and growth. private sector's responsibility and roles are going to be coming up with these entrepreneurial imagination to exploit business in those sectors of fisheries, tourism, energy, and agriculture, right? Come up with those plans. There's not a lack of ideas. Ideas are everywhere. What is the government's role going to be? The government's role at the national state level is going to be to create an environment, a business-friendly environment, so that those good ideas can get put into action. Because right now we have some things that block those things from moving forward. And so we need to, as the national government, as state governments, we need to address and take action on those things that are preventing local, foreign, joint venture investors from coming in and doing what we need for them to do to help our economy. We do all these things in the action plan. We eliminate a lot of the problems that people have. We all of a sudden become very, very attractive to potential donors. And there's a lot of them out there who want to help. The president just got done mentioning that there's some knocking at the door. But they knock at the door and they look in and they see these little pockets of problems. They see these little pockets of challenges that are going to be a little bit tough, and it makes it too risky for them to invest. We need to eliminate those so that our invitation stands for them to come on in. Now, of course, that's going to have to be measured, because we want to make sure that, you know, it's we don't get this wholesale takeover from non-FSM entities. But that can be done. All right. So last thing I will just try to highlight is the reason why this plan is different from any other. First, it's an action plan. It's got dates associated with what has to be done when. It has a monitoring system that is built in. Certain agencies, certain line departments, certain people are responsible for making sure that a certain thing gets done by a certain date, and it's monitored. That's the one thing that makes this plan different. The other one is the financing component, which has already been discussed. Resourcing this plan so that you can implement it and it doesn't sit on a table somewhere. All right, that is about the extent of my quick wrap-up of the high points of the brief, and we will go ahead and probably open it up right now to any questions, discussions, comments that you might have on the plan. We only have one microphone. We want to make sure that any questions that you have, any observations that you have, are heard by everybody. So if you raise your hand, I'll bring the mic to you, and I think it'll probably work from wherever you're sitting. Yes?
Sir, I'll take the first crack, please. Thank you. I appreciate I'm very impressed with the plan. Thank you for coming over and visit us here on the Big Island, especially in Hilo. I have three questions. Number one, first, our islands are very fragile, and I haven't seen you discuss how we're going to make sure that we protect our livelihood, our way of life, our culture, our custom. I like the plans. I like the ideas. I just want to make sure that we do have in place how we're going to protect our way of lives with all these development plans that we do have. Second part of it is I'm glad to see that we're talking about our natural resources. One of them is the fisheries. I think we probably have the most fish probably in the world. And not too long ago, in my state of Yap, we had these boats. I think it was like 12 boats, foreign boats. They came and steal clams and whatever in the lagoon. And the strategic placement of our patrol boats being in Palm Bay, and there's none in Yap. They had to use those fisheries boat and outboard motor boats as we go out to the island to capture these foreign thieves. It's kind of doesn't make sense. So I would recommend that we probably look at that as far as a strategic overall protection of our natural resources, that you look at that to make sure that maybe perhaps being so close to southeast area that we possibly thinking about placing one of those patrol boats down there to protect our natural resources. The third question or comment that I want to make is it deals with standardization of business practice. I know we have a lot of people with a lot of great ideas back there in the islands, but not having some kind of standard practice of business where taxation will be fair and there's some kind of, I don't want to say IRS, but something like that where, you know, because I look at the tax return, the revenues between the states some years ago, and I was appalled to see that the amount of business in Chuuk, that the revenues was less than what they brought in Yap, which is a small island with small business. So I just want to make sure that we implement some kind of overwatch to ensure that taxation transparency is practiced in our nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your questions. The first one is with respect to the fragile environment that we have. There is a standing policy for the government, at least at the national government, but I also recall for all governments that anything that we do we have to be mindful of our economy, sorry, our environment. So for any foreign investment, they are subjected to review for any environmental impact. If there is an environmental negative environmental impact, the business may not receive, may not be sanctioned. Our own businesses are the ones that are really damaging our environment. For instance, in Chuuk, we still catch fish the easy way, which is to dynamite. There is a substantial decrease because they're running out of materials to make bombs or dynamite. But make it short, the governments are very sensitive to negative impacts on our environment, and rightly so, because we're vulnerable. So I don't think you would be overly concerned about that, but we should be watchful. Second, you talk about plentiful of fish, but let me clarify. There is a 12 miles zone and there is ECC. Yes, there's been abuse by foreign boats, both in the ECC and the 12 miles. The national government is not responsible to manage the 12 miles zone, but we're helping. We responded to those boats from Vietnam and from what's the other? I think they're from Indonesia. So we took care of those illegal fishing. But we would like to ask the state to beef up their surveillance for the 12 miles zone, and also ask them to respect, you know, the environment and our resources. They abuse, the states do abuse. And we really have to be careful about that. I just mentioned about dynamite. It's within the 12 months. On taxation, I agree with you, and you use my state chuk. It is no longer just chuk. It's all four states. So maybe I would ask Evelyn to touch on URA, which is going to enforce tax collection. Can you?
Before I do that, I just very briefly on the environment. The 2023 action plan does not replace or undermine the existing longer term 20-year strategic development plan. The strategic development plan gives high priority to protecting the environment. So I just wanted to emphasize that that's still part of the government's priorities. This action plan focuses on how to solve this budgetary problem, but in a way that does not compromise the environment. The enforcement issue that the president discussed with you, the national government and the state governments have a very clear separation of authority over our waters. As he said, up to the 12 zone mile, the state governments have laws and law enforcement of that area. So the things that you discuss are under state law enforcement. But when they run into difficulties with these kinds of foreign vessels, they have had to request to our Department of Justice, where the surveillance boats are located under, to provide assistance. So there is that kind of cooperation that is there, but sometimes it's a little bit delayed because it's a responsibility of the states. In order to get the surveillance boats over, they need to go through some paperwork, but they do assist them. On the URA, that is exactly what you're asking for in our tax enforcement or tax administration. Those are exactly the objectives of the Unified Revenue Authority, the URA. The URA has two components. The first one is to improve the tax administration. And the second part is to change the tax system to make it one that is more conducive to private sector-led growth, but also increase the tax revenues. So the first part of it is the setting up of the Unified Revenue Authority and the Revenue Administration Act. I'm happy to say that the URA is the component of our more comprehensive tax reform that has already been enacted. Legislation has been enacted. So that's going into effect in January. The URA will become operational in January. And the whole objective of the URA is to make enforcement of the existing tax laws at both the national and the state level to be more transparent and fair. By, among other things, taking out that tax enforcement function from being a division in the line department of the Department of Finance and making it a separate and autonomous agency, the Unified Revenue Authority, that will not report to the Secretary of Finance and report to the President and then be accountable in a very direct way to Congress. The idea of having the URA is to have it to be autonomous so that the political interference that it sometimes faces can be a little bit insulated.
Let me just add to what the President and Evelyn had mentioned about the first concern that you raised with regards to damages to the environment and the cultures. As you may recall, I had mentioned that the draft tourism policy is based on the development of the tourism industry on a sustainable level, on a sustainable basis, a tourism that can be sustained by our culture and the environment. We should not implement programs or projects under the tourism industry that will come in and then destroy cultures and environment. And just recently, there was a legislation that was passed by Congress and President that signed into law that provides for the protection of the environment within the nation. And it provides for the review and provision of environmental impact assessment on major projects that are proposed to be established within the nation. So I hope that help ease your concerns with regards to the damaging of our environment and our culture.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a good question. The question about the URA, about the taxes. Just on this trip, I've already been asked three times, just since I've left Tonbe, about this URA going into effect in January. And there seems to be a lot of confusion out there right now about what exactly that is. And I'm glad you brought it up, because maybe you can also help, this group can also help here in trying to dispel some of the rumors and fears. The URA, as the director mentioned, is, well, you're familiar with probably a larger tax reform issue, a larger tax reform initiative. That has not been passed. That is not the law of the land. The larger tax reform initiative, two out of the four states have passed their enabling legislation to put that tax reform initiative or law into effect. But the other remaining states haven't done it. There's legislation in Congress that prevents any movement on the new tax reform initiative without all five governments participating. So until that happens, the new tax reform initiative is not going to become law. What has become law and what is now enacting in January is the URA. People seem to think that in January there's going to be a new tax rates. In the states, everybody's talking about, okay, what's this value-added tax all about? What's going to happen to our tax rate? People think that taxes are going to be different come January. That's not the case. The collection effort and the creation of the Unified Revenue Authority to continue to collect the taxes that are already being collected. There's no new taxes involved with the January implementation of the URA. So, in a nutshell, that's I've been approached several times asking that question about, well, I'm going to own a business. What kind of taxes am I going to pay starting in January? Well, you're not going to pay anything new. You'll just be paying what you're supposed to be paying, what you have supposed to be paying over the years. Okay. Yes.
I have a question, but before I ask the question, if I could just get your permission to go ahead and maybe open up the meal. So I'm going to ask the MUBI chief cook, Ms. Day, Vincenyon, to maybe gather some of the students, sasend them. If you could go ahead and just serve some of the meals. Let's start with the delegation, president and his delegation, and then with the children too, because there are children in here that are, and I'm sure they're hungry. And then mothers, and then if there's enough left over to the gentlemen. Okay, so thank you, just gather some of those. Here's my question, and thank you, just for the record, for all of you to know, this food is provided by our guests through, and I want to thank Micronesians United Big Island for fronting the money, but I know that Evelyn, the director, Spock, and the president will reimburse them as per their agreement with the general counsel. So I want to put that on the record so that you don't lose your money in the offer. Here's my question, I want to thank you, Mr. President, and all of you for making the time to come and meet with us and tell us this great news. We've just been visited by a delegation from Chuuk, my state, which really saddened me and disturbed me greatly. Because of the thing that I think is missing, and I think in what you're presenting as the impediments here. The question I have is, in terms of leadership, you haven't discussed, you talk about achieving in your summary statement, you mentioned or indicated that there is a sense of urgency, or the goal of coming to these citizens gathering is to basically burned fire under our hearts to say there is a sense of urgency and that we need to worry and do something about it. But here's my question. You know, in terms of sense of urgency, what I don't get, Mr. President, is a sense of urgency from the FSM Congress. You look, you know, one doesn't have to be a scientist to look at the appropriations on the FSM Congress website and see that there are appropriations after appropriations after appropriations and amendments to projects, public projects that are not going to the trust fund that the nation needs in order to mitigate this cliff that we're moving toward. So my question is, what is your assessment, Mr. President, of the state of leadership in our nation, starting with the men? Unfortunately, there are no women right now in the FSM Congress. I hope someday there will be. But right now, the FSM Congress and their sense of urgency and what they're, if there is such a thing. I mean, we can have a sense of urgency as citizens, but we're looking up to you and to your colleagues in the FSM Congress. But I'm getting that there is a sense of urgency from your side, but there isn't much sense of urgency from the Congress side of it. Could you speak to that, sir?
Are you sure you want to speak to that, Mr. President?
I have just, up to May next year I'm out, so I can't speak my mind. Thank you for that question. It's very important because we need collective efforts. Let me put it this way. Our leaders are persuaded by the public. So I would, our attempt, the reason why we go out, our strategy is to go to the public and educate the public so that the public would in turn pressure our leaders, both at the national and state level. I don't know if it would work, but we want to take that chance. We've been fighting, and it's no secret that Congress and the executive have been fighting over money. I think you have seen copies of letters flying on websites and so forth and so forth. But I truly believe, from what I have seen, when the Congress recognize a good deeds, they want to attach themselves to it. When we started the program with MRE, as I mentioned, some members of Congress were very cold about it. Now that the program has been successful, almost everyone was attached to that program. When we started the trust fund, we started, when I took over the presidency, we started with $500,000. And when you sit in my seat and see money, you know, going to areas that are not priorities, it's painful. So it was painful for me to see money going here and there, not going to that trust fund, because I know sooner or later we're going to need a trust fund. As we have seen, the trust fund from the compact is short by $600 to $700 million. That translates to about $40 to $50 million. Now, that just last year, the money has reached $13 million after so many years we built up slowly. And I also credit Roger Mori when he was in Congress, because he also pushed for it. That money last year had a balance of $13 million. You wouldn't believe what Congress just did. They appropriated about $37 million put in that fund. I am convinced that if we persist and if we get your help to persuade our leaders to do the right thing, we're going to do it. Congress is aware of the cliff and the impacts of the cliff, or financial cliff. They're aware of it. But there is that conflict. Are they going to immediately do something about it, or do they get elected first? I understand they want to get elected first. So I am hoping that after they get elected, something would move quickly, not only in terms of acting on this plan, but more money would be invested in this plan. I was not too happy when I saw the $20 million, one lump sum, put into the trust fund. I wasn't quite happy, but grateful at the same time. I wanted to see at least half of that money going to the trust fund and half of that money invested to try to grow our economy now. So it wasn't done, but at least I'm grateful that Congress now recognized the urgency and is acting on it. They just need more persuasion. Not necessarily from the president, because we still have this fight, but it would be most effective if the students especially and other people who are concerned sent letters to Congress, or even better, send email or Facebook or whatever, because all of them walk around with the iPad, all of them. So they know what is going on between me and my, other people, you, and they're up to it. So if you put that pressure on them, helping this plan, I am almost certain that we would take a giant step moving forward. But it's going to take a lot of efforts. I don't know if this strategy is going to work, that we take it out to the public, show the public pressure our leaders, but I'm very confident that it would work. Thank you.
Anybody else? Oh, yes.
Allow me to speak in my language so I can express my feelings thoroughly. MFL President Manny Mori, Natural Chief Ga Junior Hotham, Neskara Parfitego Sitsimiliter, Kantir Nisa, Sitsabur Prom, and Miss Vilkins. In Soro, Ratsa Mori, Vera Pukuro, we first saw Savakundu Group, not for us. You know, now what's a fatality? Ewits left Tavitsu, also was to Marmakurim. Por segeri kan tarapa ampon nerong nan. Kini so paman nerong awa fokun papa ngawar wisi wa mesari e plan. Amer fokun ni awara. Amer fokus sari. Wa pan bere bere sfer be takara wa por area we. E betos ngawe mesen ika mesye we we es awite. Chotsu atrore pe atsiste. Ngawite bufer tsiara norenet mebun. Pesipatoria kofes nga sa pen. Sipatoria kofes nga sa krawar krawari sa isaping. Sipatoria kwerere nga sa sabriya fyrir sripir sa akutir ratsak sa itoro pa narkwerere nga mga ikarere nga mga rakota na kuperan para sa nga mga kofes. Awa ite, rafir yung agen net togi arasit suk na ekifasun. Usut sa ito eh, sa fesiri Ekorate, usus juga aku pas pisau ni, tiba torak kawasan, pesor torak pasi penarungan. Pisau besar gula kita torak pun, TV bukan mereka, merai fosil mereka, kerugi gurai, apa yang tiba tots, apa yang pingin kita. Awin te, sari lukra, arwah sepuh, tumbuh wisir, ngeri, ekor okey cot, ekor kangres, sari lukra kangres, miring res.
Prakura Pawis, Hawa Serapura, Mokuturana, Fitimokitirina Tons. Nasipakura, Etsu, Ekor Congress, Rafri Fiti, Ekor Pomar Free Terrapons and Fiti, Alagarina Tons, Superfriatsu, Nisko Congress, Metea Fisikre, Metra Ferroviti, Purpose of Verore, and Pingin Kitchener Serapuna. Metta Sabat Kabasuan, Fair Fisheries, Maypun Pakitang, Nikre, Rafri Pania, Cosmic Toss Solution. Reparatumi akue mitasmi. Pariye patsukacu. Ma siapa pariye kiki si perfur yang lukan. Pas siapa parui resnata agusen. Merun nasibis bui keraku fuye sepatorgis neserbanan. Pariye ngapa macen orang ini si awite. Su evora isuitenge Micronesia culture. Fuye siapa besar keraku ini sokopatirerei. Ya, beberapa temuan itu juga sahabat dari sisi kalau tuh, turis beberapa cerita di turis. Pada bisnis, ngalih sebuah bisnis nggak sesering. Aku prefer dari bisnis. Awe tebur chain, mereka ke bisnis pengapar kurang konsesi tuan macu. Baru akan tes di Filipin. Baru ke konsesi pada sebuah siap ke bisnis. Awe te, yang bawa training dari bisnis ke bisnis, pas bergerak. Epat tuhi, or met kami merubah guru. Malacangan. Kini saya campur baru sangat tipis di ruang ini di sini.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you all for coming and share a little bit about what's going on back home. It's really good to know what is happening there and to know what is out there for us to think about and see what we can do. I do, looking at this handout that you guys have, and I have a question about. Number one is on the fiscal and the economic challenges. I like the fact that you guys point out all the impediments on it. And section two also, I like the fact that you guys also point out all of that. And so my question is there anything that you guys have done toward this impediment? Because I think it's good that we know what the problems are, and I'm just curious to know if there's something that was already done toward those things. The second thing is on the trust fund, I'm just curious about it. I'm not really familiar. Is it gonna be how long more and then it's gonna be gone? How long more is that trust fund gonna be existing for? I do understand that the interest is gonna be supporting after the cliff, the fiscal cliff. But what I want to know is it gonna be going on for another 40, 50, or only 5 years? So that's my question.
Thank you for that question. Let me try to respond to it, and I hope to also ease the concern that you have raised. Yes, we have mentioned that the role of the private sector is to take the lead in developing the, growing the economy through the development of the four important sectors. The government then would play the role of facilitating and easing the development of those programs in those particular areas. We have addressed some of these impediments through adoption of certain policies that specifies ways and means of eliminating some of these impediments. For instance, the trade policy has been put in place, an export strategy. The energy policy has also been adopted. And as mentioned by the director, the ODA, or Overseas Development Assistance Policy, has just been recently adopted. These policies, as I said, provide specific recommendations and actions that would be taken to take care of the problems that still exist. They provide for training of the labor force, provide for providing protection or the security to potential investors that come in from outside. Recently, we had been in discussion with the our judiciary branch with regards to the time standard to be established in coming up with decisions to be made on cases that are pending before the court. And the national government, national court, has already adopted a policy. Some of the states are in the process of developing policies to formalize the certain activities that they are doing in addressing that issue of time standard. I know that the state of Kosovo, the judiciary branch in Kosovo, has already put in place the use of alternative dispute settlement in resolving disputes between people and also between people and businesses. So those are some of the activities that each of the governments has put in place to address the issues of peace impediments that are still pending.
Many years doing strategic work across the Pacific and Asia. When I came here, I researched and read a whole lot of stuff. We have a strategic development plan, which was, we had to develop at the beginning of the amended compact because the flow of funds from the compact was on hold until we had a plan, a strategic development plan. As the director pointed out earlier, there's three volumes in that plan. If anybody's had a look at it, it's 1,500 pages long. If we take tourism an example, the tourism sector had a matrix of things we needed to do, 53 pages of them, of a list of all the things we needed to do in tourism. We have struggled to do that because it's been too wide and too broad a list. The action plan and what the president and his committee are putting in place is something a bit more targeted, so that we know what we're going to do in the next 3 years. Once we've done those things, we'll move on to another 3 years so that we can knock things off and get things moving. We've struggled in the past because we've tried to do too much across everything. So we've become more targeted. And as Roger said, you know, they've been targeting things where we're trying to get things moving. We had an example in the tourism. In the action plan, in the matrix, has about 12 things we're going to target over the next 2 to 3 years. For example, there's a new tourism framework being developed through in conjunction with the states. And part of that is some state investment plans. We have identified over 100 tourism and historical sites that need upgrading. We need to do something. The tourists are coming and they're saying, well, we can't even find. You know, we go to Sockeye's Rock. How do we get up there? Where do we go? Where are these gun places? We've identified over 100 of these and we've identified the funding. And we're going to, over the next 12 months, put in place and undertake a process across all states to upgrade all these sites using local employment, local people to do this with some external funding that was secured. So what we're trying to do with the action plan is be far more targeted and move things along. In the infrastructure sector, and we didn't really talk about that earlier on, but on the slide, there's a slide that says there's $126 million of arrears in infrastructure money. It's just sitting in the US because we haven't spent it. We've had problems with land issues in Chuuk in particular, but also problems across the states. And one of the things that we've recently talked about as a group is that in some ways we've been trying to do big projects. What we need to do is we need to do a lot, it's harder work, but we need to do a lot more smaller targeted. In Chuuk, the US have tried to force us to do a project on 23 schools at once. We're saying if we do that, that's going to get contracted out to an international company, and what is going to be the benefit, the flow-on benefit of that into the economy. So we're trying to break that project down into three schools at a time, so that when we contract that out, we can move that money, and the local companies can actually take part in tendering and winning the bids and be more involved. We're trying to do things that will move things along and involve our economy more rather than external parties. That's just a couple of examples.
Are you talking about the Compact Trust Fund or FSM Trust Fund? Compact. Okay. The Compact would, the US would continue to contribute to the Trust Fund up to 2023. Now, depending on the market in the United States, financial market, if the financial market is performing good for so many years, then we expect the trust fund to last much longer. However, if the financial market sneezes, you would probably see half of that money disappear. So it really depends. What Evelyn didn't say about the trust fund, on as far as the rule is concerned, normally trust funds, you do not spend all the earnings that you realize in a year. You have to put aside at least 5% or 10% so that you can continue to grow the fund corpus. So even the amount that we've given you of $40 million may change, the challenge would be even greater if we take $10 million to reinvest in the trust fund. That's going to be a big challenge. On the FSM trust fund, I'm not too ambitious to grow this FSM trust fund more than $100 million at the expense of the investment in the economy. Let me give you an example. If we invest $100 million in the FSM trust fund, that would only yield $6 million perhaps by 2023. $6 million is too small. If we invest that money to try to provide employment and income for our citizens, the value of that investment is much more than the $6 million. Do we understand that? If we put $100 million in the trust fund, for the FSM trust fund, at 6%, it would only yield about $6 million. What we need is to put some more money, and put money in the trust fund, and also put money in growing the economy, so that we can provide funds, I mean, employment and income for our people.
The Compact Trust Fund is designed to exist in perpetuity. That's why we're not allowed to touch the corpus. So in any given year that the market sneezes, what we're going to do is probably not draw down anything, because that's why we're only allowed to draw down the investment earnings.
Thank you. I'd like to follow the others that have spoken before to express our thanks for Mr. President and your team for this visit. We do appreciate the effort that is being put together to try to work with the problems as has been noted. I'm going to limit, because I'm just an average person, but I'm going to limit my question to some issues in general, and one is the question of, you know, I think there is some disagreement on whether the compact will be terminated or whether it's not terminated, only the financial part. My question is, what good is the relationship between us and the U.S. without the financial part? I think that in having some discussion with some of the American people here, they believe that it's terminated. When I told them that that's not my understanding, because I was in my country, I was at the highest level, working with the highest level of government, then they said, and I said, only financial part is terminated. They said, what? Then what? What good is it? So, the other question is, okay, they give us the money because of the denial rights, right? Now, if they withhold the money, why can't we withhold the denial rights? And maybe give it to somebody who is more, willing to help us. And I see that, Mr. President, as you had indicated, you're leaving office next year. What good is the plan if you're leaving? How sure are you that the plan will be followed through? Mr. President, I really appreciate your effort. But as was also brought up, are you in the same boat with Congress? One thing that he failed to mention was, you know, the number of overrides that Congress has done to your vetoes. So is everybody on the same boat? Are we going to be successful in implementing the action plan? I will stop at this point, and I hope I bring something home.
Thank you, Chef. You always ask very relevant, but also very challenging questions. Thank you. I don't know about who you talk to. It all really depends on who you talk to as far as the termination of the compact is concerned. They could be right. I could be right. You could be right. We really don't know. We have 5 years before 2023. We have to prepare ourselves to either renegotiate or terminate. Now, the little thing that I know which convinced me that it's going to continue is our strategic location. We have a strategic value. Now, whether the United States gives us money or not, as a nation, we owe to ourselves to grow our own economy. I am almost certain that the United States will continue to provide money. In the first place, which Evelyn has mentioned, the trust fund as a rule, guess who owns the fund? United States owns the fund, and they can pull that fund anytime. And when they pull, you go into 100% problem. Right now, we have assurance that this trust fund will replace part, if not all, of the compact sector grants. I really cannot tell you. All I have to do is have hopes that this thing will continue. And all I know is that the compact between the United States and FSM is designed to continue. And I don't think United States is going to risk the security of the United States by terminating the compact, having somebody else to come in and work out from within the center of the Pacific. I don't think so. And I have seen posturing, which says so. They're not going to allow that. Besides, I also do not want you folks to go back home all on one ship. Because first of all, the ship will sink. And second, when you get back to your islands, you also sink your islands, right? So we have to work together, you and us. We have to work for this plan. Because I know you want to continue to live in the United States. I'm not telling you to continue to live. I just know that you want to continue. It's a good place. You express your freedom and so forth. But let's put that aside, because it's a question we don't really know. All I know is that as a nation, we owe to our people to grow our economy. If we going to renegotiate with the United States, we need to renegotiate from a stronger point of view. If the United States asks us, what have you done? We say, here, what we've done. We don't really need all your money. We just need money for this. We don't need the rest of the money. So we're hoping that that would happen. In as far as our relationship, Congress and the President, it's common. There's, if I recall, when I was in Congress, we did the same thing with the former President Ursula. So it's not something new. But I suppose everyone is kind of apprehensive. If we don't cooperate, what's going to happen with this plan? Well, Evelyn just mentioned Congress put $5 million for this plan, to fund the fund this plan. Politically, it's good for them to put $20 million in the trust fund. You know. This plan, we still need to go out and promote. And when Congress passes the IDF portion of it, I am almost very certain that Congress would provide the funding, so long as we have ample money. And we want to have for the next 3 years, at least from my knowledge that we're going to have. Our budget is going to kick up $200 million for the next 3 years. We are now $97 million. That's how much we have grown the, what do you call it, the cash for the national government. The problem is, how do we share this money quickly to the states so they can grow their economy and take care of their problem? And so for the first time, Congress and I didn't have problem when we talk about the $39 million immediately. We got $30 million immediately after we pass our annual budget. So on the breakdown, we agree, except for one. I asked for $15 million for the Investment Development Fund. They gave me only five, and they took that $10 million and they gave it to the trust fund. So I think we're beginning to cooperate. I hope it lasts, because there is ample money. All we have to do is convince them, put more money in the priority areas and less money in the less priority areas. So I'm confident, but that's my feeling. I don't know what Congress feels. So.
Yeah,
Mr.
President, thank you.
How much binding is the endorsement of the action plan from the states and Congress?
Not really much, but it's Congress action that is binding, because we need the money. And as we all said over and over, we have plans before, but we never had funding. If we have funding for this plan, it would give signal to the private sector and for prospective investors from outside to come in. And I said, and I already said that somebody already knocked on the door. An investor is ready to invest $30 million in a hotel. And the hotel that we envision is about $60 million. If you have that kind of investment, 50% from foreign investment, that is a very attractive investment. So, and why they're not investing? Because lack of infrastructure. And Chuuk owns 120 million dollars. Chuuk is sitting on 120 million dollars not utilized. If we can use some of that money to put into the infrastructure, you not only get employment, but you would also assure that these hotels and some other activities from the private sector could be, will happen. So the government must, and unfortunately the government I talk about here is the state government. But since we have a lot of things to do with the $120 million for Chuuk State, we're hoping that they will invest that money quickly in schools and other infrastructure so that we can grow our money. So in short, I am very certain that it will pass by the SNLC and Congress would provide the funding. If they don't provide all the funding, we will seek other fundings from outside. But there's going to be funding. If our donors like our plan and it's credible to them, they'll put money into the plan. And that's all we need.
I believe your question was, how binding is the SNLC decision to endorse the plan? It's not binding. The SNLC is not a law enacting body, so it's not binding. But what are the things that the president is doing to make sure that the plan's implementation is more effectively done? He's emphasizing to you the public awareness, because he's counting on the people. When he first instructed my office as secretariat to this committee to prepare to do public awareness in all the states and then as much as we can to the constituents out here, for the first time I'm gonna admit in front of him that I found that to be an inconvenience to me, because I'm responsible for a lot of things on a daily basis. And my being away here now and all the times that we have to go out to the states to join him to talk about this plan with the public is taking my time away from the office. Now, I talk to you now, I'm gonna go back to my hotel and I'm gonna check my email and run my office from there. So it's an inconvenience to me. But sitting here, it's very easy for me to see what it is that he saw that I didn't see. He needs the public, he needs you, because when he goes out of office in May, the public needs to put pressure. Congress, not just the national, the state level administrations come and go. But our politicians are responsive to who? The people. If you ask them for the right kind of public projects, if you keep them pressured to stay on course on this action plan, they're gonna be responsive more to you than the government of the day. And that's why we're spending time and money, government's money, to come all this way to visit you and the rest of the people in the FSM to explain this plan. But in addition to that, there is plan to convene a development partners forum after the SNLC endorsement of this plan, because the president and the committee will socialize this plan to our development partners so that they can also buy onto it and also direct their support and grants to the implementation of this plan.
Aside from the public awareness and the assistance of the public and the leadership through these discussions and consultations that is being going on. As you may recall, this plan, when it was developed, it was endorsed by the SNLCO and State and National Leadership Conference to start, initiate the development of this plan. And it is not a standalone plan. It incorporates the various policies of the sectors that have been mentioned to be incorporated to be part of the implementation of this action plan, as well as the state strategic development plans. So these plans and the policies which have been adopted by the national policies, which have been adopted by our Congress, and the state development plans, which have been adopted by the leadership of the respective states, play a very good role in the implementation of the action plan, because they are part of the 2023 action plan. So that binds the national Congress or national government and the state governments to implement the 2023 action plan.
With regards to the IGOS, Chris, is $120 million for troop unspent? What happens at the end of the day if it's not spent? Thank you.
We've already had signals from the US that they want to redirect the money, so we need to move forward and start spending it. Just on another topic, or back to the other topic on would the next government pick up the plan? Well, the next government's got to do what all governments do, and that's grow the economy. You know, whatever their plan is. And this is not a new plan or rocket science or anything like that. As Roger said, this is focusing all the policies and the stuff that's been going on and being more direct and trying to make a difference in a shorter term, because we're running out of time. And so we're just trying to be more direct and focused to move things along, because we've failed on that in the first 10 years. And the other factor, the other elephant in the room that's not being mentioned at the moment, which is a very serious problem, is your economy shrinking, because for the first time ever, you've had a population decline in the last 10 years, and that's a real worry. And the only way you can stem that population decline and grow the population again is grow the economy, create jobs, bring people back. We don't want all these people studying here and being brilliant minds to then go off somewhere else. We've got to give them jobs. We've got to create an economy that draws them back and brings them back home so that we can move the country forward. And as the President said, we've got to take the first steps. If we want America and other donors to really support us, we've got to show that we're making steps. We're doing something for ourselves first, because we've got to do it for ourselves. We're not doing it for anything else. We're doing it for FSM, for us Micronesians, to take our country forward and grow it. And, you know, we've got to take the first steps and then get the others to come behind us and bring our people back and create a really vibrant country again.
I understand that there's conversation, or already has some conversation, about submarine fiber cable to link up all the states. I want to know what the status on that and what is our part in that. A couple years ago, me and a couple friends, we tried to implement some kind of communication system on the islands by placing ham radios so that they can communicate outside, just outside the FSM if they need to. But I know that there was some kind of friction that we felt some friction at the national level as far as issuance of the call sign. At least that fiber optic communication linking up the states and easing up the red tapes on issuing license for ham radios for the outlying islands. Thank you.
The negotiation with the World Bank for the $51 million is for the cable from Guam to Yap, and then the other cable to Chuuk, which is coming from Ponapaz. In terms of COSRAI, there's work going on with O3B, which is a satellite company, which is a cheaper way of getting it to small islands So that work's going on, and hope that it's not quite the same quality as a submarine cable, but it's a very, very high quality. And so that's being looked at the moment.
I just want to mention that we don't get the fiber optic just for you and me to talk. That wasn't my intention to seek the money. It's simply to make sure that the tourism industry, which depends very much on affordable and effective telecommunication, that was the main reason why I wanted. And also to make sure that health and education are also effectively and efficiently communicated among themselves.
Honorable Congressman, President of Micronesia, my first question is, what causes the fiscal year budgets to go down in FSM? And another question is, what did the government of Chu do to all the money that goes to Chu?
I would ask Evelyn to answer here both questions. But you know, Evelyn and I differ on how to look at this problem. I look at it from a budgetary point of view for the entire FSM without the compact, or including the compact. In my simple analysis, our budget by 2023 could go up to, and I was playing with some figures here, could very well go up to $200 million, including the compact. So what I want to tell you is, what we've been talking here tonight is simply just the compact. Just the compact. Imagine we have to fix our roads. We have to pay for the legislatures, for other activities that are not even part of the compact. Our budget would hit $200 million. And the small portion of problem that we talk about is simply the compact funding. And I want Evelyn to talk about that, to answer your question. But think in the bigger terms. What would be our budget, all five governments, in 2024 rather? It's about 200 or more than $200 million. And we only have about 40-some million dollars from the United States, from the compact. Where are all the money coming from besides the compact? We have to grow the economy and so forth and so forth. So can you answer her question, sir?
I'll try. Then what I can't answer, I will delegate to the person I can delegate to, since the president has delegated. The first one is, what has happened to Chuuk's share of the money, the compact funding? Historically, under the amended compact, before that, we can talk about later, but under the amended compact, what you saw there is that the majority of Chuuk's share of the infrastructure funding is still sitting unspent. So it has not yet been spent. There has been schools, very nice ones, that cost $1 million that have been built across the three states, but no schools have been built here in Chuuk with the new funding since 2004, because that money remains to be spent, and that's what Rob was talking about. We need to get it out. Some of the things that Chuuk State has used for its share of the money is, it used it to help the CPUC to purchase new generators. So now Chuuk State has 24-hour power, instead of before there is no power and everybody has to have generator who can afford. It has also used its share of the money to build the Wena Road. That's a very expensive and long delayed project, because it involves setting up water pipes, sewer, and then pavement in a very small area of Wena, the town. So those are the kinds of things it's done with its infrastructure money. The rest of the money that is for Duke State has been going to fund the operations of the schools. So all the schools are funded entirely with comeback funding. All the teachers, everything. Also, the hospital is being entirely funded by the comeback funding. Some of the things that Duke State has also used its money for, the smaller sectors, is the running of the finance and budget offices, the state office. Also, some private sector funding for the business development center, the small business development center, and some outreach and extension programs for agriculture and fisheries conservation management. These are the things that I can think of. Why is the compact funding going down? That is the design of the compact funding. It was designed to go down every year in real terms because the smart people who negotiated the compact thought that we as a country would need to improve our self-reliance, and so that grant funding goes down in real terms every year until we hit that big cliff in 2024. So the matter of becoming more self-reliant and developing an economy that and budgets that rely less on government funding is the whole point of the compact, is for us to become more economically and budgetarily self-reliant.
Mr. President, I'm glad you're here tonight. Thank you. It's nice to see you again, the rest of your delegation. I have a question about fairness, I guess. In your development plan, you're talking about, for example, tourism. And I think that's a good idea. I'm just wondering, in Chuuk, for example, like probably in the app as well, there's the main island, Wada, and there are the outer islands. In your plan, is there some provision that you've come up with to ensure that the benefits are spread around all the islands, not just the district center, what used to be called the district centers? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. We do have plans for the outer islands, but like the main islands, we also need infrastructure. We have money for the airstrips in some of the other islands. We need that so that we can take tourists out to the other islands. We have also, we are grateful to the government of Japan for giving us a new ship. And the ship is more passenger friendly. We have more confidence that more tourists will go out to the other islands in the near future. The only problem is that transportation and some small hotels. But as far as security and enjoyment, they're all out there. They have unspoiled environment. If the plane comes in next year, a small plane, it should be able to take tourists out there. And we do not anticipate to see big hotels, or it's got to be thatch roof and real nice hotels. We were fortunate, Emma and I, fortunate to visited Cook Islands. We went out to the other islands. They had fantastic hotel rooms. But they use that room. So we want to emulate that. And the rooms are very expensive, despite the fact that they're that room, about $300 a room a night. So we have that prospect. It's just a matter of getting this thing moving. I am very certain that if the money is provided, a small hotel in some of the islands, in the other islands, would gravitate tourists out there, and provided that we have that small plane running, and the airstrips are safe for those smaller airlines. So we're confident that they would go out there, eat fresh fish, fresh breadfruit, drink coconut, go on the beach, whatever they want to do, unspoiled. Are you convinced?
I'll just quickly mention the other project that's very much focused on the Outer Islands and the very extreme Outer Islands and the rural communities, which Roger mentioned earlier. The Petrocorp project, Coconut project. This project, the CBA has been around for a long time and really didn't quite get to where it should be. So that's been folded into Petrocorp now. Petrocorp has already tendered out to build two new coconut processing facilities, and I'm not sure if they've decided exactly where yet, but I think there'll be one in Chuuk and maybe one in Yap. They're going to upgrade the one on Ponape, and they and when the president said that the Japanese have providing a new ferry for the Outer Islands, that is likely to free up the current vessel, which I think the government's in the negotiation at the moment with Petrocorp to allow them to take over that boat to get around the Outer Islands. Their coconut project, within 2 years they anticipate putting around or purchasing around $4 million worth of coconuts on outlying islands, little villages, rural communities that have no cash economy at all at the moment. And they're in the process, they've already started, they're working with Pingalap at the moment on their processing facility and looking at other out islands, pretty much close to Ponape at the moment, but will get right around the whole country within 2 years and start a process of regularly visiting with a ship, forward ordering or knowing what coconuts that are being collected on each island, and they will go out with cash, or they'll go out with already with goods on board that the people want to purchase and take that out. There's a very, very good project, and it's based on some stuff that was done in Fiji, and it's very successful there, and I've seen it operating. So we're really, really excited about that one. That's got the possibility of bringing in around 10 to 12 million annually in overseas earnings as well, and creating around 500 jobs. So it's a very exciting project, and it's totally aimed at Outer Islands, rural communities that do not have a cash income.
Thank you so much, Mr. President, for being here. And it's my first time actually to meet you and the rest of the delegation, except actually I know you're Consul General. My name is Rose Batista, and I am the immigration specialist for the County of Hawaii. And it is a pleasure actually to meet with and work with a lot of your constituents. They have now become my constituent, and I've learned so much from them. This is so wonderful in you bringing all this information, especially to people like us. So I guess I'm speaking as an American on the American side, listening to all your plans. This is wonderful, and I hope I'll be able to travel to your country and visit it, and I know it is beautiful. But my concern is, so you have 9 years, basically, to make this time up. And when the compact was initiated some over 20 years ago, those were the conditions by the Americans, if I'm not mistaken, right? So you can be self-sufficient. So there was a reason for that money being reduced every, I forgot how often it was, but the reduction because for that purpose. Now, so you even have money sitting, you know, for your infrastructure, and nothing has been done in over 30 years. And now I'm just curious to see, so you have 9 years to do it. So what is it that took you so long, or will it take so long to implement all this action plan when you had all the time to do it, and now you have this remaining short period of time and to put fire on everybody, on your constituents to say, we're gonna do it. I'm just curious, how will all these plans be realized and materialized in such a short period of time when you've had ample amount of time in the past? Thank you.
Thank you for being so kind to our citizens and for the questions, very relevant. I'm going to ask the staff to answer the question, but we set out to identify the impediments, and that is one of the, actually it's the biggest impediment. And without solving that problem, we are going to continue to have problems on installing new infrastructures. Chu is recognized of it and also under pressure to utilize that money. And I just heard something from Rob that the United States is now willing to divert that money. And I hope the leaders of Chuuk hear that, because if they don't act quickly, that money is going to be diverted to the other states. The state of Pohnpeyab and to a certain extent Kosan, they do not have problem with so much problem with land in as far as installing infrastructure. It is Chuuk that has a very serious land problem, and that's why we have that $120 million sitting. So I think that amount of money is going to be dissipated, actually all expended before 2023. I am very confident of that. It would be dissipated. If the U.S. gives the signal that they're going to divert, meaning it does not have to be all in Chuuk only, that money would disappear very quickly.
That money will disappear because it'll be utilized. I mean,
it will not disappear. That share going to Chuuk is dictated by FSM national government law, a distribution formula that is established by FSM national government law. So what the U.S. has been hinting to us is that GEMCO is not bound by that FSM distribution law. It can, in fact, allocate that money to the other states. So it is in the interest of the FSM for that money to be allocated respecting our own distribution formula. So it's in our interest to spend that money effectively. On your question, the first compact was up to 2003. During that compact, there were no rules on how to spend the money. So we effectively didn't have a hard time spending the money. We spent all of it. And then the US, your government sent out the GAO and they did a review and they found some problems on how we spent the money. So the amended compact funding from 2004 to 23 is dictated by strict and, in my opinion, very overwhelming rules. And because of the introduction of these new, very convoluted rules that I have to deal with as being in charge of the compact implementation, we have been having problems spending all of the money. We're learning the rules now. So our carryovers each year has been going down. So the non-infrastructure is only an accumulation of 20 million. It's going down every year. We're spending it faster. The infrastructure remains the problem, because under the amended compact, we have a new set of rules that we have to abide by before they will draw down the money to us. And as the president said, most of that money is for Chuuk, and it's mostly because of land problem that they're having accessing this funding. What are we doing to ensure that we spend the money effectively? We're looking at the institutional setup in the FSM, the project management unit that is in charge of coordinating with all the state governments to ensure the proper documentation is collected and submitted to OIA to meet the requirements of the compact is done effectively. We're looking at that under a technical assistance, TA, and we hope to have the right institutional setup put in place no later than at the end of, at the middle of this year, so that we can have the greater absorptive capacity for these compact grants and spend it down faster. And it's part of the action plan. Spending it is so important. As the president said, it's gonna take time to get the engine of growth going for the private sector. In the meantime, we're gonna go after that 100 million that is still sitting unspent to spend.
Hi, Mr. President. I really appreciate your time and your group for coming and sharing with us this great idea. And all this thing is really better for the life of the people. And my question is, if all this is work out fair, is the minimum wage an example in Chu still be changed?
Of course. Yes.
There's the economist, he
said. I think that's an easy one. I mean, any economy that grows and advances and becomes more wealthy, the wealth gets shared among the economy. So as you grow and as companies get more profits and become more profitable, then they share with their employees. So of course that would go up. I just want to go back to one other, the previous topic, and I don't want to be rude to either, I'm an outsider, I'm a Kiwi, so I can say this. I think the amended compact failed on one thing that I'd like to point out. And I'm going to read, because you touched on the mutual principle of the amended compact, was to promote economic advancement, budgetary self-reliance, and economic self-sufficiency. Right? There's only, the only way you can do that is to grow an economy, right? Because everybody has to pay for their education and health. How do governments do that? They tax the people. And you can't tax the people if you've got no economy and it's not growing. The amended compact spends all its money here. The president's talking, we need to grow the economy. How much of the amended compact is going into private sector development? It's all gone into the social sector. We've forgot that we're after economic self-sufficiency and we're not putting any effort into that. The amended compact just turned around in its details and said health and education will be number one priority, which is very fine, but you need to have a balance. And you've got to put money and effort into growing the economy if we're going to be self-sufficient and budgetary, have our own budget. So that's what the whole premise of this is about. You know, we've got to grow the economy so we can get the taxes to pay for our own social services. And the amended compact missed that a little bit.
First of all, I want to say hello, aloha, welcome to all of you, our visitors from home. And I wanted to ask, I'm not sure if my question has been asked. I'm wondering, because since I entered, I hear all the concerns, comments, questions asked was all regarding infrastructure and how we're trying to better our country or FSM and some downside of Chuuk. But my question is, we're looking at economic wise, are we also taking into consideration the resources we have in our homeland as far as utilizing the talents, the resources we have, as well as not depending too much on maybe sending away the kids to go to school, but utilizing all the past practice that we have, which also includes holding on to the culture, which plays a lot of significance in how we deal with our economy.
Towards the beginning of this session, there was a discussion on culture and environment and how the current action plan incorporates preserving that. It is part and parcel to this plan. It does not ignore the fact that, in other words, if we want to promote tourism, we still have to ensure that there are controls in place to ensure that tourism doesn't destroy what is part of our historical culture and traditions. And it goes along the same line with the environment, right? You also asked about, you said you heard about infrastructure and you wanted to know, retaining, utilizing the resources we have within the FSM. Yes, I'm not sure exactly when you walked in, but the action plan outlines all the different sector areas that need to grow, that that we need to exploit in the private sector, which include our fisheries resources, our agriculture resources, our natural beauty and attractiveness to get tourism also, which is another sector, and then the final sector being energy. So we, in order to grow the economy, we need to be able to safely and responsibly exploit our resources in the FSM to help to grow what we need to grow to get our economy moving, because right now it's flatline. Yes?
May I just have a follow-up question?
Yes.
My follow-up question is in regards to fisheries. Yes. And I visited Juk in 2009. It was sad for me to see that the past practice of how we go out and catch from along the shore, it's almost gone. It's been depleting. And so how does that, is that part of the fishery in FSM to take almost pretty much everything out of the ocean, even along the shore? And because we're now into looking into, oh, we're gonna make money, let's gather all this, go into other people's land area, gather what we can, and to ship off to get the income we need.
I think you may not be giving enough credit to how much work has been put into, because if I were to hand this over to Roger Mori right now, he would tell you that fisheries is not about, and this growth of the economy, is not about raping the land. It's about utilizing what we have sustainably, so that we can continue to exploit the benefits that we have and balance it against maintaining a sustainable stock. If you were to look at what fisheries are happening, what is going on with fisheries on the high seas today, if we're not careful, everybody who comes in to fish the FSM waters has the potential to fish our waters clean. If we don't maintain, which is why we have a robust enforcement capability or a robust enforcement plan that we are attempting to implement in the FSM today, to ensure that we maintain a balance between being able to utilize these fisheries to our advantage and at the same time maintain their sustainability for the future, because we cannot allow our stocks to completely deplete without, because it doesn't do us any good, right? We need to be able to sustain it. And that's part of the reason why this plan relies on a sustainable actions that are implemented in a responsible manner so we don't deplete what we currently have. Because everything is finite. These things will run out if we're not careful. And you give a good example about Minchu.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you everybody for coming and visiting us. My question has to do with those big numbers, education and healthcare. And we're talking about this plan as an emergency response to all the problems happening. And I think healthcare and education are those real issues that are actually happening in our population back home, and it's reflecting in our population here. Because that's the issues that we're dealing with. So what is our government doing to address those issues, to inspire our people to be healthier, and to inspire our kids to be more educated and throughout Micronesia? Because those are two major problems that we are dealing here as a population from Micronesian nations. And it's becoming a social problem here within the state of Hawaii, and it is because it's reflecting on how our people are coming here using resources that are here that we don't have back home. How are we doing to address those problems to our people? Because I think, as you all address it up there, it's a major part of the economy. Thank you.
I'm going to talk social sector here, okay. There is a lot of programs going on. I've only been in Pohnpei for 5 months, but there's a lot of good programs going on. There is a shortage of money, and money can only come from, we've got a finite amount of money coming from the compact, and it's declining, as we've heard. The only way we can top that up is with our own money. So as all governments do, you grow your economy, you get some taxes, and then we put some more money into health and education and expand our programs, do more on preventative health care. A lot of what's going on still is focused on, you know, reacting to the problems, not being proactive. So, and that only comes about from being a more developed economy. It's a common problem throughout the world. And small island developing states is very expensive healthcare. It's very expensive to get healthcare out across the islands. And so you only have that basic healthcare. So we've got to get our own resources so we can complement what we're getting from the compact and put more money into health and education, into the preventative care and programs that explain to people about good healthy practices. There is quite a lot going on in this. Just back in the last couple of, in the last month, there's been a couple of walks and runs for health and getting people out doing healthy things, and it's been really good.
There are really two sides to this, right? And it's not uncommon anywhere else. There's preventative, and then there's active, which is reacting to emergent ailments. The more homework and the more actions we take on the preventative side, theoretically, that reduces the amount that you have to spend or the amount that you have to pay attention to and take care of in reactive mode. So I don't think you're going to find that the things that are going on in the FSM are any different than what's going on anywhere else in the world. I mean, the FSM folks, whether it's state departments of health or whether it's national government departments of health, are participating in those same forums and those same organizations that are trying to promote healthy life choices. What is one of the things that the government is trying to do concretely? Import substitution. Okay, we have gotten very, very accustomed and very comfortable with some very processed imported foods, and that's just a fact of life. How we promote our own produce in an attempt to make sure or try to ensure that we can replace substitution, replace processed and imports.
Briefly, the health and education is a shared responsibility between the national government and the state government. You would note that the national government does not have hospitals nor schools except the College of Micronesia. That means most of the activities and responsibilities rest with the state governments. But we do help in as far as bringing technical assistance, in as far as bringing money, and in as far as building schools and hospitals at the national level. And we have talked about preventive measures than curative. It is also my policy that for any government function, all that you drink and eat must be 90% from our own resources, meaning local food and local drinks. But we would not satisfy your questions because it has to be answered partly by the state governments, but we are helping.
I have to apologize because every meeting I just have a lot of questions. And sometimes I tend to be very upset if I don't ask my questions. So as a concerned citizen of Micronesia, I wanted to ask a question on, I'm sure you're aware that we are currently approaching a time where FSM COFA migrants are going to be ineligible when it comes to applying for the Quest insurance, which is the state insurance. And we're going to end up paying for, go through a process of eligibility within the age group that is specified under the state law. to see what kind of medical insurance will be eligible for. So this is in the U.S. This is in Hawaii, not U.S., in Hawaii. We're going to end up paying for our medical care. And all these concerns, and I thank you for coming out to share with us what's been happening in FSM and in the different states. One question I always have is, are we inclined to help the economy or our infrastructures, or as a way of helping the taxpayers pay for all their taxes by looking at the medical side of it, having people maybe pay? Or do people in FSM pay for medical services? Those are questions. I am not sure what's been happening in FSM or in the respective states. Or are we inclined to also giving maybe little charge to improving the economy back home? Because obviously when medical is gonna be a problem for us, I don't think FSM will come out and help us with our medical issues out here.
On the details for the, I mean, I'm familiar overall with what has been happening, but on the details as to how it directly impacts every one of us, I just know that it's gonna go away. Yeah. Now, I would, Mr. President, do you want to address that one, or do we take that back to our health folks? And because I don't have enough details.
Quite frankly, I didn't really catch the question.
The whole point of the action plan, which the presentation you missed, Mikaela, and I can give it to you after this, is to grow the economy. So yes, that is a very serious concern of the FSM government, and that's what we're trying to do with this action plan, is to grow the economy. I think one of your specific questions was whether the governments are also looking at charges, you know, the users paying fees at the hospitals. The user fees in the FSM for the health sector is very, very small as a portion of the budgets for the hospitals. The one state that has the biggest user fee is Yap State. GEMCO, which is the committee that approves, reviews the budgets for the compact grants and approve it on a yearly basis, it's already looking at encouraging the state governments to increase its user fees, so that when you go and pay the hospital, you're not just using it, but you're also paying a bigger amount of money than now. And as a GEMCO representative from the FSM, I'm afraid that this is going to become a requirement very soon.
Thank you, Mr. President. I say my greeting to you all for coming, and thank you for the opportunity. I would like to ask a question relates to the mandate for the distribution of funds in the FSM. That back in the compact form, that they use the distribution formula of 30-70. And with that in mind, I've been one that has been bothered with the fact that we in Chuuk were the disadvantaged state in the union, considering the fact that here in the United States, the minimum wage is figured based on cost of living. In Chuuk, the cost of living is so enormous compared to Pohnpei and the other states, because we travel by sea almost every day, and the money is being spent in the water. For Pohnpei, they spent only like $5 on taxi cabs and stuff, like the other states. Would this task force, have they considered about changing or put in place something that should change this disadvantage for Chuuk when it comes to the economy, because I'm pretty sure that Chu, as far as the credit for the economy and the fiscal problem there, I think we're far worse compared with other states. So I hope that the delegation members or the task force members are not here, so we can address our questions, and our governors from our states, they can listen and hear what our concerns here. And as a Chukis, I'm really concerned because of this distribution formula. It's been very, very unfair to the Chukis people. Thank you.
Thank you for the question. To my knowledge, Chug has not brought the issue to the state national leadership conference. So we hope that Chug will raise that issue with the SNLC, maybe in January. But let's go back to the first compact, because what you talk about is water transportation compared to land transportation, which is more costly to go by water. The estimate is that during the first compact, Chuuk expended $100 million on land sea transportation. And I think it was, I don't know, I've been asking myself, why didn't we spend some of that money on these terminals? Terminals meaning, you know, you've seen trains, right? They come and go within 5 minutes or 7 minutes, right? The government of Japan has asked me, if you only build terminals, we may help you with ferry boats. You know, ferry boats, huh? So, looking back, if you get expended some of that $100 million on terminals in each of the Nokon Islands, we would not have a problem with the water transportation. But I agree with you, it's very expensive. And unless something has changed, we will continue to burn with the cost. But as far as the formula, Chuuk has to bring it to the leadership. They cannot just complain and use that as an excuse to move out from the Federation. They need to bring it to the leadership. In the first place, it was settled through the leadership. And as a federation, you cannot get all you want, especially a big state, at the expense of the small states. So that's why you have this 70-30%. 30% was equally divided so that you can satisfy some of the needs of the smaller states. But the 70% is in recognition of the bigger population for Chuuk. So there was some kind of workout balance between the smaller states and bigger states. But that is no excuse for us to leave the Federation because of the disparity in the distribution of funds.
Across all my join.